I want to thank your company as well. You know, Mera brought so many nice memories to me. If you have a chance, you know, the Mera, it doesn't look like much, but it's a wonderful building that has a wonderful smell about it because they make spices and coffee. And there's a place in my hometown, Montreal, called Chabanel, which is very much like Calio, where you guys are. And my Italian aunt used to work at the coffee roastery. And that smell always brings back my childhood. So I actually walk around your building sometimes, you know, just, you know, to remind me of where I come from. It's a really cool area, just generally. I wanted to answer a very difficult question, and you probably have that in your own countries. You know, why do you do what you do? In this case, you know, why is Finnish coffee so damn popular? You know, 10 kilos per person, that's crazy. You know, in Italy, you know, which would associate to coffee, we're talking 6 kilos, 5 kilos, a lot less, half of what the Finns drink in coffee. It's crazy. Why are they so crazy about coffee? We are in the middle of the freezing cold, away from where coffee's grown, very far away from where, you know, coffee's grown. It's Latin America, in Africa, in Asia. We're very, very far away. And I came up with an answer. Are you ready? I came up with an answer, a lot of which was already presented to you. But I have a few more insights, if I may. I want to talk about three things today. I want to talk about the three drivers for coffee success in this part of the world, especially in Finland. Now, I want to talk to you about science, I want to talk to you about love, and I want to talk to you about dreams. And I think those are the three things that drive the coffee culture here. One is science. You know, Finns are obsessed with science. Finns are a very fact-driven country, and it's a very, very strong part of the country. It has brought and created wonderful companies, triumphs in engineering and pulp and paper and metal. And you see this also in the coffee culture. It's an obsession with quality that is part of the coffee culture here. I have to confess this. 20 years ago, when I started working at the University of Jyväskylä, I took my first taste of Finnish coffee, and I instinctively spit it out. I wasn't used to the light roast. I'm more of an espresso kind of guy. So I actually spit out the coffee. They thought it was very rude out of it. But then, you know, it's sort of, you know, I got used to it. And because for a light roast, you actually need much better quality coffee than a darker roast. So an obsession with quality and innovation. And what's really cool is that, you know, I'm a business speaker and writer. And what's interesting is that the Harvard Business Review did a research on, you know, what makes innovative companies. One was, you know, a correlation between how much social space there is in the company versus the innovative results of the company. Social spaces, including, of course, spaces for taking cups of coffee. The greater amount of space you have for these spaces, the more innovative your company. There's a direct correlation here. And no surprise that Finns are one of the most innovative nations on Earth. We have 30 patents per 100,000 people in this country, where that figure in the US and Canada is one patent for every 100,000 people. Highly innovative country, and this is a driver of innovation, is putting people together. And one way to put people together is coffee spaces. So that's a huge driver of this country's success over time. Now I want to talk to you about love. You know, if you want to leave with one joke from Finland, this is one of the standard jokes in this country. You have an old couple, they've been married 40 years, and they're having a cup of coffee in the morning. They're in silence, of course, and they're reading their newspaper. This is a very typical scene. And then at one point, the wife says, "Husband, you haven't told me that you love me in 40 years." And then the husband takes some coffee, puts the newspaper down, and he says, "Wife, I told you 40 years ago that I love you. If there are any changes, I shall let you know." But what's in this story is critical, is that they are together around these cups of coffee, and they've been around these cups of coffee together in love for the past 4 years. Not saying I love you, but drinking coffee sort of replaces that, you see, in a nice way. Now, and it's not only the men here, you know, the Finnish women like to complain, but I like to complain about Finnish women as well. You know, my Finnish wife, you know, and I have an Italian background and French Canadian, so, you know, what I do is I have this nasty, you know, way of speaking. You know, I say, you know, we have coffee in the morning together with my wife, and at the beginning I used to say, oh, you look so beautiful today, and, oh, I love you so much today, oh, you're like a breath of fresh air, you're so gorgeous this morning. And then at the beginning she said nothing, you know, she just smiled, but now we've been married 15 years, and, you know, just last week we were having, you know, Kultakatriina. This is what we drink. I've been drinking this stuff for like 20 years. And we drink this, and I say, oh, babe, you're so gorgeous today. I love what you're wearing. And she looks at me and she says, I'm going to teach you a Finnish word now. She says, hölö, hölö. Which is not a good thing. It's sort of being, you know, be serious, be rational, stop it, or just drink your coffee. I know you love me. It's a waste of time. Yeah. But coffee brings people together in beautiful ways. Also, in businesses, you know, I do a lot of consulting in this country, and one of this country's top CEOs. I won't tell you who he is, but he's one of the country's top CEOs. And I tell him, you know, I'll call him Pekka. Pekka is probably the most common Finnish name. I said, Pekka, you know, you gotta get out there. You gotta go and talk to your people. You do some management by walking. You know, go and see them and talk to them. You get a feel for, you know, problems in operations, problems in other parts of your business. And he says, I can't do it. What do you mean? No, I have nothing to say. I tell you what, here's your cup of coffee. And you're going to walk there and you're going to say, let's have a cup of coffee. Oh, that's easy. And then he starts doing management by walking because he had a coffee cup in his hand. You know, something that he would be, you know, naturally expected to do, again, is a catalyst for human interaction. And also for human rejection. It's interesting. You know, I have an Italian grandmother. She died. She used to live with us. My Italian grandmother, God bless her, Nonna Maria, she used to live with us. And we drank a lot of espresso at home. And you know, but, you know, it was one thing, you know, that would insult my grandmother the most is that you didn't eat her food. You know, she'd make all this wonderful pasta and stuff. And mangia, mangia, you know, just eat, you know. And if you didn't eat, you were a bad person. You're on her blacklist, right? And I remember that when the first time I met my wife's grandmother, he said, you know, I don't mind if you don't eat my food, but if you don't drink my coffee, you're on my blacklist. All right. So you might be very careful. You cannot, you know, make people angry that way in this country. Lastly, I want to talk to you about the third driver of why coffee is so huge here. So there's the scientific aspect of it, and the innovative aspect of coffee. There's, of course, the love part, the interaction, the social catalyst idea that we were already introduced to. But I think dreams are really the things that drive us. And you know, when this, dreams, you know, it's we're so far away from the places where coffee is grown, is that when you're in the middle of minus 30, in the darkness, in the Arctic, my God, it's nice to have a piece of sunshine in your hand. Warm sunshine. That's what it is. It's the exotic. It's my God. For a very small price, I'm traveling to South America. I'm traveling to Africa. I'm having the impression that I'm there. And from an identity perspective, it was important for Finland not to choose tea. You know, they fought the Russians during the war. They actually fought the Russians away from during their civil war. There was no way that we're going to take, you know, the Russian tea culture into this country. There was no way that was going to happen. You know, it was part of the European identity to take on coffee and to take it on with a vengeance. But, you know, one analogy is interesting, and I think that we should maybe think about exporting this one. What I used to do, I was a big fan of Finland before coming to live here. I became a lawyer in New York, and I was a lawyer in Montreal and New York, and I used to drive sometimes from Montreal to New York, and it's a long trip, you know, it's about an eight-hour trip, and I used to take some colleagues along, and it was the cassette days. Who remembers the audio cassette day? Anybody? I thought these were young bloggers who were invited here. My God, jeez, a lot older than I thought. Anyway, I had these wonderful colleagues with me, and what did I listen to? I listened to something really, really strange. I put it in, and it went like this. It went,
Sixona suruinen, kun suarit muistele, niin paronnen kansa skaulista pois. Sixona suruinen, kun suarit muistele, niin paronnen kansa skaulista pois.
You have just heard, thank you very much. You have just heard your first Finnish tango. How did it sound? As weird as the coffee, I know. Finnish tango. I became fascinated with Finnish tango. My colleagues in the car, and I also brought some coffee in the tourist in the car. It was a long trip. We had Finnish coffee and Finnish tango. And in the beginning, my friends would go, "Oh my God, we can't take it." But then they started calling this André's Finnish moment. Finnish experience. If you want, take a ride with André, you know, he's driving, you know. He always listens to this strange music with the Finnish coffee in the turbans. It's very strange, yeah. But think about tango, the same thing happens here. The same dream. It's the furthest way you can imagine, you know. Right now, guess how many people go to the largest Argentina tango festival today? How many people attend, you know? Throw out a figure. What would it be? 1,000 people? No more. 100,000 is your guess. Yeah. Well, that's a good guess, but now it's gone down. The biggest one actually has only 9,000 people. 9,000 people in Argentina, where tango was born. Here in this country, and I had the great pleasure of singing in this tango festival here in Sydney. And it's, you know, they closed down the streets of this town, and 100,000 people, as you said, 100,000 people are there. Dancing tango into the night. It's a dream. It's also a catalyst for human interaction. You go to the tango festival to celebrate your love with someone or to find new love. And both are a big part of the Finnish dream. And both, I think, are very much a part of the Finnish identity. It's so wonderful to come into good cultures and really appreciating and understanding in which ways you are unique. Even as people, it's so important to embrace our differences, embrace our coffee, even if it's a bit strange, embrace our tango, even if it's a bit strange, but it's powerfully ourselves. And I discovered this, and something really crazy happened to me. I fell in love with a Finnish woman, 15 years ago, and she decided that my Finnish was crap. So she said, "From now on, I'll only speak Finnish to you." And 10 years later, they voted me Speaker of the Year for this country in Finnish. And it was a long haul. I gotta tell you, it was every day being called a stupid foreigner was not nice by my wife. "You're still not learning this language, you stupid foreigner." But then it made me stronger, and then I realized that, you know, what makes us stronger is our identity in all of its aspects. And I really realized this in this building, in this place. 2 years ago, I was moderating one of the world's largest business events, and we had a great speaker. He was called Arnold Schwarzenegger. Does that ring a bell? Yeah, Arnold was here. And you know, I was moderating a session, and Arnold comes in, you know, and he's a huge guy, what a wonderful man, and go through the logistics of his speech. You know, you're going to be standing here, I'll be asking you this question, then we'll move on, we'll ask another question, open it to the audience. And then he stops me, he says, with his Terminator eyes, he says, "But, who are you?" Hey. Yeah, I know. I sound like I come from New York or Montreal, but actually, I'm from here. I'm from Finland. They voted me Speaker of the Year last year. Yeah. And he said, "What? You?" I said, "Yeah." He said, You mean, speak out, Ida? You finish? I said, yeah, you finish. And then he asked me a critical question. He says, André, do you have an accent? And I said, actually, yeah, when I speak Finnish, I have an accent. And he said, huh, André, your accent is okay disadvantage, yeah? Be yourself. Everybody else is taken. Thank you very much for your time. Thank you.